Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Limitless by Robert J. Crane, narrated by Nicole Poole. Chapter 1. 2 years later. The alley smelled of blood and fear. The stench and signs of death spread all over the red brick. It was a back street in Chelsea, a barely passable gap that wouldn't have qualified as an alley in America. A car might have been able to squeeze through, but only one of the smaller models that were popular in London. London. Again. I'd wanted to come back, but not like this. I took another sniff of the smells drifting through the alley. Blood was the easiest to identify. I had a lot of experience with blood. I had a lot of experience with fear, too. But the smell of fear I scented here was different. The sort of thing you'd catch in a toilet, if you get my meaning. Each step I took, my heavy boots thumped on the cobblestones. I passed under the yellow crime scene tape as though it was something I did every day. It wasn't, but I had done it enough to not even feel the thrill of unease or anticipation anymore. From just the smell of this place, I could tell it was going to be messier than the stuff I was usually called in to consult on. I rounded the corner into a narrower space, a dark offshoot of the alley that was even smaller and more foreboding than the one I'd followed thus far. There was a man waiting for me just around the corner, wearing a tan trench coat to protect him against the April chill. He had a mess of light brown hair that was styled in such a way that I knew he had either spent an abundance of time on it or almost none at all.
"Miss Nealon, I presume?"
He spoke with a British accent, of course. He looked to be in his late 20s or early 30s and was tall enough. He was wearing a white dress shirt with a tie just a little loose around his neck. He wore his trousers pretty well, I had to say, even from the front. He rested his hands on his hips expectantly, standing sentinel in the middle of the narrow passage. "I'm Sienna Nealon, yes?" I said, giving him a short nod. I wasn't really in the mood for pleasantries, but for him I made an almost unconscious exception. He gave me a beautiful smile, and I felt my patience growing by the moment.
"I'm Detective Inspector Matthew Webster."
He offered me a hand, which I stared at for only a moment before I shook it quickly and without ceremony.
"If you'll follow me."
"Sure," I said, following him. I'm not much for gawking, but I was cursing his trench coat every step of the way.
"Delivery man found the remains early this morning,"
Webster said.
"He actually walked around the scene for quite a while before realizing there was even a body. Trudged through carrying fresh produce into the restaurant's rear entrance here."
He gestured to a solid steel door built into the wall. "Okay." I listened to his commentary as I trailed behind him. I rubbed a hand over my face and stifled a yawn. He glanced back and caught me before I could finish covering my mouth. He gave me a brief look of contrition.
"I suppose they woke you in the middle of the night to get you over here so quickly?"
"Caught me about an hour after I'd turned in, yeah," I said, trying to shake the sleep out of my head. I gave him a tight smile. "It's not unusual, though. Go on."
"Right."
He turned and kept walking just a few more feet to what I assumed was the scene. I didn't see much, but the blood smell was more pronounced here.
"We found the largest part of him here."
"Part?" I asked. I hadn't exactly gotten a ton of information before I'd flown over. "So the victim was in pieces?" Webster looked at me, lips pursed as he concentrated.
"What exactly did they tell you?"
"Almost nothing," I said, stifling another yawn. "State Department called my agency, requested me for some sort of murder investigation that you boys in the Met had cooking. They call, I go." That's the way it was, the way it had been for 2 years now, moving at the beck and call of the U.S. government. "They really didn't tell you anything?" Webster looked a little pained. He kind of had angel eyes. His empathy was touching. "I get called all over the place, and I'm rarely told anything until I'm there," I said with a shrug.
hazard of the job. Or at least it was nowadays. I suppose there aren't many people with your particular set of skills at this point.
I looked him right in the eye. There aren't any.
Right, I suppose.
Webster said, averting his eyes.
So, yes, we have a body. The commissioner called your State Department for a different reason than you think, though.
So this isn't a metahuman crime? That was my job, policing the people who had powers beyond those of normal humans. Usually my jurisdiction was limited to the United States, though. I'd only consulted with foreign governments a few times.
Well, we think it might be,
Webster said, bobbing his head slightly left and right as he answered. The alley was empty, save for the sick smell and us.
You already moved the body?
Couldn't leave it out,
Webster said.
We assumed that you'd be the better part of a day arriving, so the scenes of crime officer already cleaned up and did their work.
He flashed that smile again. I still liked it.
Imagine my surprise when you show up 4 hours after the commissioner made her call.
It would have been less, but your government made me land in an empty field north of London and ride in via car, I said, staring at the crusted brick on the wall next to us. I glanced at the heavy steel door at the back of the restaurant, noticing hints of blood here and there throughout the scene. So, the body, how many pieces?
Webster blanched. A lot, more than I've ever seen.
That's messy, I said, and knelt next to one of the spots of blood that had already dried. Victim's name?
Maxwell Llewellyn,
Webster said, and he squatted next to me. I felt a cold, clammy chill run up my spine that had little to do with the London weather.
Sound familiar?
Shit. Yeah, I knew him. I couldn't place the face, but I remembered the name. He was a meta, all right. One of us, we few who remain.
We gathered as much,
Webster said, looking quite comfortable squatting down next to me. His coat dragged on the alley floor.
Checking up on him, we found his travel arrangements to America a couple of years ago, seeking sanctuary from what happened when you lot had that crisis.
Yeah, he was one of a group I tried to protect during the war, I said. Webster blinked when I said it. Most people didn't think of what had happened as a war. Then again, most normal humans didn't even know what was happening until it was already over. I let my finger drift over the blood that caked the ground, watched it flake at the tip of my finger.
I'm a little surprised he ended up dead in an alley,
Webster said.
Aren't your people supposed to be stronger, faster, all that?
We are, I said. Some of us are stronger and faster than others. Max was low on the power scale. Not much of a fighter either. We had him doing secretarial work, until he and the others decided they'd rather hunker down and hide from the rest of the war on their own. I stood, leaving the blood behind. I don't know what I'm looking at here, other than a murder scene. Maybe it involved a meta as the killer, maybe not. A normal human could have overpowered Max, potentially, in a few ways.
Well, that's actually not why we called you either,
Webster said, breaking my concentration. I stared at him, at that chiseled jaw.
There's a little more going on here than that.
Listen, I said and ran a hand along the back of my neck. I like to help as much as the next person, but my agency is a bit maxed out at the moment. Besides, I'm not the person you should be talking to on this. I glanced toward the mouth of the alley and saw a hint of the gray day that waded out of the darkness. There are a few metas over here who were closer to Max than I was. I'll put you in touch with them. Maybe they can tell you what he was up to.
Why are you whispering?
He asked, leaning toward me a little conspiratorially. I shrugged. Because of the EU ban on metahumans in your countries? His eyes ticked slightly to the left, then to the right.
I don't know if you've heard, but the UK isn't doing very much to enforce that ban.
I chuckled, humorless.
Then you're the only ones who aren't. He matched my chuckle with a low guffaw.
It's a bit of that old American invention, don't ask, don't tell, around here. Brussels went a trifle mad with sanctimony after that Italian incident. It was your brother who did it, wasn't it?
He said it like, wasn't it? My brother, yeah, I said, peering back at him. It wasn't exactly a secret, since that little incident had been reported on every major news station in the world, and my name got dragged into it even though I'd been safely at home in Minneapolis at the time.
Anyway, we've had more than a few barnies with Brussels, from things like bans and bananas to whether inmates have the right to vote, though, and I reckon one's coming up about their stance on metas.
Webster shifted, pushing his hands down in his pants pockets, elbows out. He was a wonderful specimen, standing like that, a crusader for justice and whatever.
That's a nice blow for equality, I said, almost yawning.
Still, I don't think I can help you with Max. I'm not much of a detective, and I only knew the victim in passing. Like I said, I can put you in contact with a couple of people over here who worked with him in the past.
Webster made a tutting noise.
By any chance, are you talking about your friends Janice and Karthik?
I blinked and felt a slight chill. There was a chance he could have picked those names up off the same list that he'd found Max on.
Yes? Why?
A chance.
Ah, well,
he said, shifting his attention back to the puddle of dried blood at our feet.
That's why the commissioner called your State Department asking for you. See, their names did come up when we started looking into poor bloody Maxwell here, but they'd already been brought to the attention of the Metropolitan Police weeks ago.
For what? I asked, frowning.
Janice and Karthik were many things, but criminals?
Well, not exactly.
Missing persons,
Webster said, and he dropped his hands into the pockets of his trench coat, snugging it tight.
They were reported missing 6 weeks ago by another person on your sanctuary list, Rory Kilmeade, and we haven't been able to ferret out a peep from either of them since.
Chapter 2. I let Webster give me a ride back to his headquarters in his car. It was one of those smallish British ones. Might have been parked in the alley, for all I knew. I stared out the rain-dotted window as he drove, mulling over what he'd told me. Janice and Karthik were missing. One or the other would be suspicious enough, but both? And in the short span of time before an acquaintance of theirs turns up as a dismembered corpse? Beyond suspicious. There was a connection here, and the only thing troubling me was whether it had something to do with them being metas.
Did you know them well?
Webster spoke into the silence. The only sound other than the engine and his smooth British voice was the clicking of his turn signal as we prepared to make a right.
Janice, yes, I said. Karthik, a little less so. I worked with them both for a while during the war, but Karthik left before the end. The heat blew faintly out of the car's vents.
Janice. He'd stayed with us to the very end.
Can you think of any enemies they might have had?
Webster said, wheeling the car to the right.
I'm sure they had them, I said, but I don't know who they might be specifically.
With Janice especially, the list could go on for pages.
Anyone from your rogues gallery, perhaps?
Webster said this with a smile. If anyone else had been asking, it might have sounded smug and slightly assholish. He managed charming, which was why I answered as sweetly as I could. I don't have much of a rogues gallery, I'm afraid. Like that was a bad thing. I felt my face straighten into hard lines, and I looked back out my window. They pretty much all ended up dead. We lapsed into another silence. While that admission might have shut other lesser men up for a good long while, Detective Inspector Webster was back at it relatively quickly.
So, you've been to London before?
It didn't come off as much of a question. I didn't bust him on it, though.
Just the once, I said. It's a beautiful city. After we managed to dredge up the file involving the passport, Webster said, shooting me a sly look. I looked at some of the criminal reports filed around the same time as your friend's departure from England.
He paused.
Saw something about a teenage girl in a traffic collision with a car up near Russell Square. She mangled it so badly that the engine dropped out.
I kept a straight face. I hope she's all right.
Something in the same area, he went on. Some sort of foot chase in a hotel nearby, a fracas in the National Museum a few days later.
Oh, for crying out loud, I muttered.
There were an awful lot of murders that cropped up around that time.
He was probing. I didn't even glance at him.
Lots of shootings.
Century, the people behind the war, I said. They hired armed mercenaries to wipe us out. It got messy. That was an understatement.
Maybe you can tell me all about it sometime, he said,
and he sounded genuinely hopeful. Sure, I lied. I might have had diplomatic immunity now, maybe. I was a little fuzzy on how these things worked, but there was no way in hell I was going to revisit the good old days with a detective inspector. There was dumb, there was stupid, and then there was confessing all your sins to the local police. I was dumb, and occasionally stupid, but I didn't plan on sinking to the third level.
Here we are,
he said, and we passed a sign that proudly proclaimed New Scotland Yard, just like on the TV. Or telly, I guess they called it. I shook my head as we entered a parking garage. I followed Webster into the building, on my guard, but trying not to look it. He kept glancing back at me like I was going to bolt at any second. He gave me a reassuring smile each time, and I was practiced enough at social niceties that I responded in kind. In reality, though, I was feeling a little more like the cat in the dog pound after his discussion of unsolved mysteries.
"Right in this way,"
he said, holding a door for me as we entered a bullpen filled with activity. There were a lot of plainclothes police officers inside on phones, their accents so thick they melted together into a fascinating audio stew that even my practiced ear couldn't sift through. The smell of coffee lingered in the air, the cheap kind, brewed in a pot that had probably been around since the Brits had ruled half the world from their island. People were hunched over their desks, looking at paperwork, staring at computer screens. It was like any other office I'd been in, except for the atmosphere of tension that underscored it all. That wasn't something you'd see in a copy machine repair shop, unless massive layoffs were coming, maybe.
"Have a seat over here,"
Webster said, guiding me over to his desk. It was clean and neat, not a file left out. There was a desk calendar and a computer monitor, both perfectly positioned. Nothing else inhabited the space. Not a picture of family, not a school diploma, nothing. If he'd told me right then that it was a temp desk and he was only using it for now, I wouldn't have questioned him. I stopped short and took a seat in the chair alongside as Webster stripped his coat off, folded it in half, and hung it on the back of his chair. I decided that the careless look of his hair had to require tremendous effort, and his otherwise natty appearance suddenly made more sense. The man kept things neat. I leaned against the back of my seat as he sat down in his own. I watched him as he rolled it into place and shook the mouse to wake his computer. He slid out a drawer to reveal a keyboard and logged in, glancing at me out of the corner of his eye as he did so. Did I mention he had angel eyes?
"Ah, here we go,"
he said, causing me to look away.
"Looks like the medical examiner has had his say on this."
"Let me guess," I said dryly. "The cause of death was being filleted into tiny pieces."
"Actually, it looks like a heart attack,"
Webster said, focused on the computer screen.
"I don't know exactly how he made that determination, but it would appear the dismemberment happened post-mortem."
"Wow," I said, thinking that one over. Chopping someone up just to dump their body in an alley.
where it would almost certainly be discovered, keep in mind,
Webster said. He twisted his lips as he read the screen and tapped one finger idly on his clean desk.
They didn't even make an effort to dispose of it, and with it, him, in that many pieces, it would have been easy to at least try.
A public display of some sort, I said, thinking it through. But who would do something this messy, this brutal?
I'm not exactly a profiler,
Webster said, sliding back in his chair, which squeaked as he did so. He regarded me in a posture that looked lazy, but his eyes were intent.
This mess, though. I mean, it could be personal, someone with a grudge, or it could be a serial killer.
Or neither, I added. Or both.
Did your examiner find any DNA at the scene?
Not a bit, other than the victims.
Webster shook his head.
The scene was short on blood compared to what you'd find in a human body, so the victim was definitely killed somewhere else and brought here.
My head spun with the possibilities, but I kept myself upright in the chair. Personal score? Random killing? Disappearances of metas? I stared straight ahead as I considered it, then turned my head to meet Detective Inspector Matthew Webster's brown, soulful eyes with my own. I could see he had some questions. I just had one, really. What the hell was happening here in London? Chapter 3. The old man screamed when he got cut, and that didn't bother Philip Delsom at all. He took a leisurely path away from where the bastard hung upside down from his chained ankles and picked up his bone-white china teacup and saucer from the table they rested upon. He saw the red from his thumb smudge a bit on the saucer, and that drew a frown. He should have known better than to take a sip before washing his hands. This was a messy endeavor, after all. The screams were a delicious sound. They caused him to prickle with anticipation all across his skin. They were a symphony of a sort, high and primal, primitive music that harkened back to the days of instinct. Philip had discovered early on that he liked the sound of this particular kind of music, though he'd rarely had a chance to listen to it in the last few years. The world had changed, after all. Gone were the days of setting a leisurely pace of life. The digital age, they called it. Life moved frenetically, everyone feverishly scrambling to speed up. Philip took another sip of the tea, which hadn't gone cold, fortunately. Not yet, anyway. He preferred to do things at a slower pace, take his time, do the thing right, make them suffer. The last one had suffered greatly, and for a long time, too. Why, he had barely remembered his name at the end of it. It was all wet croaks from a voice so strained it might as well have been broken. Philip took a sniff of the Earl Grey in his cup and found it quite the joy in contrast to the scent of blood and fear that suffused the room in which he stood. "You know," Philip said, placing the cup and saucer back on the table and turning, slowly, to face the old man hanging by his ankles from the ceiling. "I'm rather enjoying seeing you bleed." He adjusted his glasses, wire-framed spectacles that he loved because they looked at least 50 years out of date. "Seeing you suffer. I could enjoy watching this for years to come."
"You would,"
the old man croaked. It caused Philip to raise an eyebrow. Not many people could lose as much blood or skin as this fellow had and still remain cheeky. Philip tried to recapture his sense of joy, though the subtle hint the old man had thrown at him nettled more than a little. "But I'm afraid I just don't see a very long future for you." He made a vague gesture with his hand and the old man screamed again, this time from the pain. Philip had made him scream from terror at least a few times, and those were choice screams indeed, especially from a tough old bastard like this. "It'll be memorable until the end, though, at least for me." Philip took a step closer and ran a hand down the old man's chest. Knife work had exposed tissue to the air that was not supposed to be out and breathing. It was messy, really, but there wasn't much to be done for it. He reached further up, came to the hip and thigh where the damage done by yesterday's handiwork had started to heal.
I can't imagine you'll enjoy it, but I can assure you that I'll find the whole process immensely satisfying.
Philip smiled, and then he jabbed a finger into the newly knitted flesh and started peeling it off in a long strip. The screams followed, and that was all to the good. Philip found himself humming along with them, trying to match the pitch as best he could while he worked, tirelessly, on the old man, burying himself in his efforts and barely noticing the mess he continued to make. Chapter 4.
So you have no knowledge of who might be behind this?
Webster asked me. I was getting a little chilly sitting in New Scotland Yard, but the faint hope in his eyes as he asked the question helped keep my disappointment at bay. Not a clue, I said, giving him a short shake of the head.
Is it possible?
He started, and I cut him off. Anything is possible, I finished for him. Absolutely anything at this point, which is the problem, really. You could have a random act of violence. You could have a planned act of violence, a mugging and abduction gone horribly wrong, a revenge killing that...
Hang on a minute.
Webster held up a hand to stop me.
What if we operated from the assumption that this killing is connected to your friend's disappearances?
I shrugged my shoulders.
So what if we did? I guess at least then you'd have something to work on.
That's the spirit,
Webster said and flashed me a smile. He turned back to his computer and pecked at the keys with one finger on each hand. I watched him coolly, pursing my lips. He glanced up at me and made a faint noise, an embarrassed guffaw.
Never have learned how to use a keyboard.
Me either, I said, taking my eyes off of him and letting them roam around the bullpen. I caught a hint of interest as he cocked his head at me, waiting for further explanation. They didn't offer typing classes where I did my schooling. He returned his attention to his half-assed typing. With a sigh, I leaned over. I think I've kind of reached the limit for how much help I'm going to be able to give you on this. His eyes flicked to me in surprise.
What about your friends?
I felt my stomach rumble just a little. I don't know if you could call either of them friends, acquaintances, co-workers, maybe...
War buddies?
Maybe, I said. Whatever the case, you've got an investigation started, and frankly, I'm a little out of my depth here. I don't think there's going to be much I can do for you on this, and I've got a world of trouble waiting for me on my desk back in Minneapolis. That was entirely true. I was presently inundated, working about 80 hours a week for less pay than I'd ever worked in my life. I mean, I was head of an underfunded agency that was in charge of policing metahumans across the United States, and while we were a small part of the population, about 500 or so, we were not a quiet part. Plus, a lot of the crap that flowed my way had nothing to do with metahumans, but I had to investigate to rule it out anyway. That was fun. I'd been called down to Ohio one time because of reports of some sort of fish-type meta living in a local pond. It was actually some weirdo who liked to take naked swims with a shark fin attached to his back. That image was forever seared into my mind. They didn't make a mental bleach I could wash it out with, unfortunately. Like I said, crap flowed my way, and that was one of the milder examples.
I've got a list, he said, and I heard a printer nearby spin to life working on something. Lost known addresses for these people you dealt with.
Refugees, I corrected. We granted them sanctuary after all, so really they were refugees.
Right, these people,
Webster said, and he scooted back in his chair just around the corner of the cubicle and returned a second later with a piece of paper clenched between his thumb and forefinger.
They're out there.
He glanced at the paper.
They could be in danger.
I'm sure you'll warn them,
I said warily. Wearily, too. Those two always came together for me somehow.
I've got to talk to them all,
Webster said, making the paper dance as he held it out in front of me. I couldn't decide whether he thought the way he was doing it was enticing or if he was just trying to hypnotize me. Yeah, we call that canvassing, I said. I've done it. It's not the fun part of police work.
I could use some help,
Webster said. I sighed. Not to be an ass, but so could I. I'm one of two, count them two, responders to metahuman threats for the entire United States. I had really felt the entire part of it over the last 2 years. I have a stack of investigations on my desk about 6 inches thick that I'm supposed to be working on, and just about the time I get it down to halfway, the U.S. State Department sees fit to loan me out to some other nation whose metas were nearly exterminated so I can deal with whatever threat they're facing. Which is fine, except that when I get back, my little pile of folders will have increased back to a full 6 inches or more. I joked with my brother, the only other responder to meta threats at our agency, that our caseload was more prolific at breeding than rabbits. And on the rare occasions when our folders turned out to be filled with something serious, it was usually hairier than rabbits, too. Webster studied me with a practiced eye. His finger traced that rugged jawline as he seemed to consider what I said.
So, working this one case with me would be like a holiday of sorts.
He smiled. His smile was boyish and damnable and ah! I rubbed the bridge of my nose and shut my eyes. I had a perpetual headache these days. My brother kept insisting that I go to the doctor for it, but I hated my doctor and knew what she'd say anyway. It was stress, or the product of my abilities, or an impending brain hemorrhage. Part of me was rooting for the last one. I pulled my hand back slightly and looked out at Detective Inspector Matthew Webster with one eye only. He gave me that smile and cocked his head invitingly.
Ah,
I said aloud this time. Fine. I'll canvass with you. I saw his smile widen in victory. But if we find nothing, I'm out of here so fast it'll shatter your windows from the sonic boom. Deal?
Absolutely,
Webster said and stood, tugging his long tan coat free of the chair and then sliding it back under his desk.
Shall we then?
We shall, I said and followed him out. And I wondered why the hell I was doing this. Then I saw him walk in front of me with the coat folded over his arm instead of blocking the view of his backside, and I knew exactly why I was doing it. Chapter 5 Webster broke the silence as we rolled along the London streets.
You know, I saw you on the news.
I glanced to the side and he blushed, briefly, before expounding.
When it happened, you know.
You and everybody else in the world, I said. This was all old hat to me by now.
The whole world, eh?
Webster smiled. It was disarming. I looked away in order to keep composed. I went to China for a diplomatic mission last year, trying to foster cooperation because they lost pretty much all their metas at the opening of the war. This guy on the street recognized me and asked me if I could turn into a flaming dragon for him. Technically, I could do that. I'd done it on footage that had millions of hits on YouTube. Of course, I hadn't known I was being filmed at the time, and I hadn't done it since. Webster paused before answering.
I suppose it's a rather impressive party trick.
I just blinked, looking straight ahead out at the rain-dappled windshield. I think that's the sort of trick that would send most people with any sense running from the party.
I suppose I've never been all that sensible,
Webster said, turning his attention back to the road. I glanced at him out of the corner of my eye. He was smiling faintly. Know your limits, I said, keeping an eye on him.
A wise practice in general,
he replied.
Do you follow your own advice?
I have no limits, I said quietly, looking back at the road as he accelerated through a green light.
You say it like it's a bad thing.
I paused before answering, giving it some thought. It's not an easy thing, that's for sure. Finding out you've got power, real power, the kind that has a real purpose behind it, and knowing you have to use it responsibly, it's not quite as glamorous or glorious as you might imagine.
If you'll forgive me saying so, Webster said, nudging the car gently into a turn. You sound like you're a bit worn out.
Probably.
Maybe you should seriously take that holiday, an actual one.
Can't, I said. Every time I leave for a few days, my life gets measurably worse. There's only so much of me to go around, you know?
So you do have a limit,
he said, and I caught him smirking faintly. My patience is certainly limited. I kept it relatively gentle, and by his expression I could tell he took it as banter, which was good. Seriousness was my biggest drawback, and frankly, he was right. I did have limits, except in the area of metahuman power. No one could match me there, at least no one I'd met in the last few years. In that one area, I was limitless.
So, you're super strong, right?
Webster was eyeing me again. I was familiar with this sort of curiosity. I'd been on the receiving end of it more times than I could count when I went out in the field and had to cooperate with local law enforcement, other federal agencies, or even just people on the street. Yes.
And then there's the whole dragon bit,
he said.
The flames are a nice touch, by the way.
Thanks, I said. But the fire is an independent thing. I just combined them when I had to kill Sovereign, that's all.
You shot some sort of light at him as well,
Webster said.
Some kind of web or something?
It's a net, I said. Made of light. It's pretty strong. Tough to break out of. I'd used it a lot lately. For the last couple of years, actually. It was my non-lethal option for confining and restraining.
And you can fly.
It's how I got here so fast, I said.
You flew over without a plane?
Webster looked slightly astonished.
I mean, I knew they picked you up outside the city. When you said you'd flown into an empty field, I assumed.
It's a 9-hour flight from Minneapolis, I said. Only leaves during normal airport operating hours. I wouldn't have been here until tomorrow if I'd gone commercial. I ran a hand through my long dark hair, which still felt a little frizzed even though I'd tried to contain it in a ponytail while I rode into London in the Foreign Office car.
That means you must be able to fly at ridiculous speeds,
he said, not taking his eyes off of me. I gestured toward the road. He looked back with a hint of contrition but kept stealing glances at me. Supersonic, yeah, I said. At least until I hit the coast of Ireland and then I had to turn it down a little bit.
My God, Webster said, shaking his head. Why not just fly right into the middle of the city?
Your government, I said with a slight tug of a smile at the corner of my mouth. They didn't want me flying where I can be seen. Apparently they want to sleep with me. They just don't want to be seen with me the next morning.
Yes, well,
he said, clearing his throat, out of embarrassment, I suspected. I thought his next question was going to be some variation of what else can you do, but he kept it in check. After a moment's silence, he followed up with a question I did not expect.
So, with all that power at your fingertips, why did you decide to run yourself ragged working for your government?
I opened my mouth and hung it like that for a moment. That was not a question I was used to getting. I had an answer anyway. Because if I didn't, I said, who would? He looked over, met my eyes, and nodded once. I would have sworn I saw a hint of sadness or something within them, but I wrote it off as me not knowing him very well. We lapsed into a comfortable silence, lulled by the quiet tapping of the rain at the windshield and the gentle thrum of the car's engine as we drove onward. Chapter 6. Philip had to take a good long scrub after finishing with the old man. He wasn't dead, the crotchety old bastard, but Philip suspected he wanted to be. No one could lose that much skin and be sanguine about it. Except in the other sense of the word sanguine, of course, the bloody one.
"This is it?"
he asked, taking a good long look out the window of the car. It was raining, of course, as the London sky was prone to do, gray clouds hanging in a low ceiling over the scene. But he could still see the small house across the street. He had to look across the driver to see it, a worn-down brick house far on the outskirts. They'd been driving for a while to get here.
"This is it,"
Liliana Negrescu said to him, her low, harsh voice tinged with a Romanian accent. She'd been living in London for years, he knew, but showed little sign of ever fully adapting. She was a sharp-faced girl, and she still looked like a girl, except in the darkness, where she looked like a scary, hard-edged witch he wouldn't care to trifle with. Her dark hair was pulled back tight, and her black eyes flitted to look at the house.
"All right,"
Philip said, buttoning his tweed jacket before he opened the side door to get out.
"Quick and quiet is the name of the game, then. You take the back door, I'll take front."
She acknowledged him with a slight hiss that was almost a signature for her. Liliana didn't speak all that much, and when she did, it was straight to it. He liked that about her, but it was hardly her biggest selling point. The knives, those were her biggest selling point. They were both out of the car in a moment, moving quickly but casually. They kept to human speed, but when they reached the door just off the short drive, Philip knocked while Liliana disappeared along the side of the house without a sound. She wore street clothes. In them, she looked surprisingly normal, as long as one did not stop to ponder the vast darkness of her eyes. Philip took a sniff of the wet air, a few drops of rain coming down on him as he stood outside the screen door, waiting for someone to answer it. He forced a smile onto his face. He was small of frame, and his glasses made him look even less intimidating, he thought. If only they knew, no one would ever open the door for him. The white door clicked open just a crack inward. Philip kept the smile perched on his lips and angled his head to look in. There was a face there, that of a young man. Angus Waterman was his name. He was slightly paunchy and had a mane of red-brown hair. His eyes were small. He reminded Philip of a rat hiding in a hole and staring out at a threat.
"Yes?"
Angus Waterman asked. Philip had the feeling he was looking at him as one would stare at a door-to-door salesman. He was going to be ever so disappointed.
"Mr. Waterman?"
Philip asked, and waited patiently for the answer. He already knew, of course, but this was the game to be played.
"Yes?"
Waterman replied, still looking cagey.
"Can I help you?"
"I doubt it," Philip said smoothly, his smile broadening. "You can't even help yourself, after all." Waterman took a moment to register the surprise before he attempted to slam the door. Philip managed to brace a hand in and stop him. Waterman was a weak meta, his physical strength so low on the scale that a strong human might have been able to overmatch him with a little effort. And Philip was no human. The door flew back open, Philip's hand pressing an imprint into the wood as if it were wet clay. Waterman ran. Philip already knew exactly how that was going to play out. He stepped inside and closed the door gently behind him. No need to make a scene, after all. He wiped his feet on the mat, listening without much interest. It was all so terribly predictable, unfortunately. Took some of the fun out of it. The scream was exactly as he'd known it would be when it came, the sound of Angus Waterman catching a punch to the throat. It cut off when Liliana landed the blow to the side of his head that knocked Waterman's infantile brain into unconsciousness. Philip, meanwhile, stepped into the kitchen. The kettle was boiling just as he'd known it would be. He took a moment and poured a cup, taking his time as he heard Liliana in the back of the house. Philip knew what Waterman's future entailed, and it involved a stint wrapped up in a rug.
"Hit him again," Philip called as he stirred a lump into his tea.
Otherwise, he'll wake up in the trunk and make a frightful ruckus.
There was a short, sharp grunt of acknowledgement from the other room, followed by a dull thump. Philip felt a tingling sense of satisfaction and took his first sip of the tea. He made a face. It was quite cheap. There was the sound of a car outside, and Philip froze. He reached out to his surroundings and felt a sense of urgency as the realization hit him, something he hadn't predicted yet. The police would be here in seconds, and they had help. Her help.
Liliana,
Philip called, icing the sense of discomfort he felt.
The police are arriving and shall be knocking momentarily. Be a dear and ready poor Angus for his journey.
He reached into his breast pocket and pulled out the item Antonio had given him for just such an occasion. He could sense that it was going to make one hell of a bloody mess. But then, by day's end, Angus Waterman wouldn't be much in need of a house anymore.
I'll need a moment to prepare for them before we set off.
Chapter 7. I still wasn't used to riding on the wrong side of the car or the wrong side of the road. We were in a town called Hounslow, on a street of brick homes that were called townhomes in America, sharing common walls with the residences immediately next to each house. There were breaks in between every other dwelling that allowed for tight alleyways. The space next to the house we were going to, domicile of one Angus Waterman, whom I didn't remember at all, had been planted with a bank of trees. They didn't have much space to work with, but it was a nice break between houses.
You remember Angus?
Webster asked as we crossed the street. There were cars parked evenly down both sides, only a few scattered spaces available.
Not really, I said. I'm not that good with, people, I added, just being honest.
Webster must have thought it amusing because he let out a low chuckle.
Think he'll remember you?
Probably, I said. I do tend to make an impression.
I froze before the white door and noticed it was just a hint ajar, with a palm print pushed into the wood. I stared at it for only a second before I pulled my gun.
What the hell?
Webster started and took a step back. He looked murderously angry, and suddenly I was glad the pistol was in my hands, not his.
What is that?
6-hour P227, I said, keeping my weapon at low rest as I sidled up to the door.
You can't have that here.
He muted his outrage to a respectable level in terms of loudness. The fury oozed with every word, though, unmistakable.
Handguns are illegal.
Yeah, well, his door is open and my mental alarm is going off because someone has clearly forced entry. I nodded to the indentation in the door. That's something it would take meta-strength to do. Now, are you coming in, or am I entering on my own?
You can't go into someone's house with a weapon drawn.
He was nearing apoplectic, but at least he was being quieter about it.
It's burglary, at least.
Come in and catch me, then, I said, and shouldered my way into the entry without looking back.
Damn it,
Webster said, but he was right behind me, and not preparing the handcuffs, thankfully. I slid into the entryway and found myself in a small room only a few feet long. I could hear the scrape of shoes across the tile ahead and the faint hiss of water just unboiling. I doubted Webster heard any of it, and I was going to look like a real ass if it turned out that Angus had just left his door open and had made that palm print in wood himself. He hadn't. I stared at the guy standing across the kitchen from me. He wore a black ski mask, in contrast to his neatly pinstriped suit and tie and the cup of tea he held oh so properly in his hand. Except for the mask, he might have been any distinguished British gentleman. A pair of older spectacles perched on his nose reminded me of Janice, but even through the mask I could tell he was younger.
Hello, Sienna,
he said in a classic example of a sophisticated British accent. Every syllable was perfectly pronounced, none of the rough edges or balled-up phrases that fell out of Webster's mouth.
I must say, I'm surprised to see you here. Surprised and pleased.
Can't say the same, I said, surveying the kitchen as I came in. My pistol was still at low rest, but I could snap off a shot at him in milliseconds if I had to. You're not Angus.
Indeed, I am not, he said as I made room for Webster, who followed behind me wordlessly.
He had a baton in his hand now, and it took me a second to register that that must be what they gave British cops instead of guns. I gently thumbed back the hammer on my pistol and felt a lot better about my chances to stop this guy than Webster's.
Where's Mr. Waterman?
Webster butted in. He still looked angry, but it had transferred to the man in the mask instead of me, which was a lot cuter. He had kind of a flush in his cheeks. Ahem, never mind.
You just missed him,
the masked man said and took a sip through the slit that exposed two thin lips.
I'm afraid he has a rather urgent engagement that will be keeping him occupied from now until the end of his life, which shall be arriving very soon. You're the murderer,
Webster said, voice gone cold.
You're under arrest. You must keep him around for his looks,
the man in the ski mask said, looking me straight in the eyes. They say the eyes are windows to the soul, and if that was the case, this guy had a serious case of empty rooms lurking behind his. I couldn't see anything in them, not a flicker, not a hint, save for maybe just a little scorn or anger, I couldn't tell which.
Because he certainly doesn't have a bloody idea what he's up against, does he?
Do you? I asked, not looking away from those cold, pitiless eyes.
I've long been an admirer of yours, Miss Nealon, he said in that cultured tone. You were the first of us to really open the world's eyes to what we're capable of.
He chuckled lightly, an utterly humorless sound.
Of course, it was such a dramatic display that I don't think they really know what all of us can do, even going on 2.5 years later. In any case, it seems rather fitting as I go public with this endeavor of mine to let you know that I'll be killing you.
I raised the gun and squeezed the trigger without waiting for another word. The pistol roared twice with the fury of the 45 ACP rounds nestled in the magazine. I saw Webster Blanche next to me, ducking away from the gun as it belched fire out of the barrel. But the masked guy? He dodged both shots, disappearing into the darkness of the hallway behind before I'd even finished my double tap.
After him!
Webster said, rushing forward. He recovered quickly. I strong-armed him back, catching his chest as I slipped into line with the hallway where the masked man had disappeared. It looked empty, but appearances could be deceiving. I heard movement in the back of the house and took 4 hurried steps across the kitchen after him, and failed to notice the trip wire hidden in the darkness until my ankle caught it. The world exploded around me as a bomb went off with the fury of thunder and lightning striking all around me. I barely had time to register what it was before the flash of flame lit the room. Then the world dissolved into smoky darkness as I fell to the ground, pain dragging me into unconsciousness. Chapter 8. Philip had already made it out the door when the bomb exploded, catching that little twat in the blast. Antonio had called it his version of a claymore mine, whatever that was. All Philip cared about was that she was down, the little bitch, and she wouldn't be following him.
Come on, come on,
he urged Liliana. She followed in his wake. Angus Waterman rolled into a long, unsightly rug on her shoulder. Philip licked his teeth nervously, striding down the side of the house, feeling tree branches claw at his arm as he passed. It was a curious sensation, like someone was dragging wet fingers across the outside of his coat. He noticed it, detached from the sensation, as he followed the path. He pulled the ski mask off and pocketed it just before he came into the open in front of the house. He paused, running fingers through his lightly mussed hair, smoothing it back into place. The street was quiet, not a hint of movement anywhere. The gray sky hung above, foreboding, as though it could hint at the destruction he'd just unleashed in the house behind them.
Is she dead?
Liliana asked in that flat voice of hers. Did she have a hint of nervousness in it?
Well, who wouldn't?
No, Philip said, not stopping as he stepped off the curb.
She heals quickly as well, so we need to remove ourselves from the situation before she gets a chance. When will she be up again?
Philip felt a brisk charge of annoyance prickle across his skin.
I don't know. That wasn't exactly true, but he didn't have time to delve into it at the moment. Soon enough, we need to be fully prepared before we face her.
Liliana did not argue with him. She knew better. There was no sign of traffic, no sign of anybody. The bomb going off in Waterman's house had left his ears ringing slightly, but his hearing was better than most, and he had been closer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.